Hi folks, hope you're okay today, it's good to be with you. I just want to talk to you about, I want to share this to the Christian community, those who go down to Hyde Park. I've been watching quite a few videos about Christians going down to Hyde Park. And I just wanted to give you a bit of advice about debating Muslims at Hyde Park. And, you know, I just put this video out and I just offer it to you to think about and to pray about. And I hope it's a blessing to you. So, so much to say, but so this is basically a resource video. You know, a lot of the title of this video is a title that a lot of Muslims put on their videos concerning debates in Hyde Park. And so the Muslims are making these videos saying, "Oh, another Christian destroyed in Hyde Park in debate," and etc. They're putting these videos up, and what's happening is a lot of the time is, these Muslim apologists, they look for people who have not trained or got a lot of knowledge concerning Christianity and Islam, and they'll pick on these Christians, and these Christians mean well, they try to do their best. And then the Muslims film these debates and say, "Oh, look, another Christian has lost the debate or looks stupid or whatever." And I just want to give some encouragement to people who go to Hyde Park, and you know, just to offer some advice and some resources that might help you. Okay, I think first of all, you know, you need to be more prepared. You know, you need to be much more prepared. If you just turn, let's just go to a few verses. Let's just go to Titus. Yeah. So this is just a resource, really, just to get you thinking and help you really to be better equipped in your ministry if you're going down to Hyde Park to debate people. I'm just going to give you some tips, some help. So if you go to Titus, right, chapter 1, it says, verse 5, "For this cause I left thee in Crete, that thou should set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city as I had appointed thee. If any man be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly, for a bishop must be blameless, as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, not striker, not given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate." Verse 9, "Holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers." Now, I believe that men and women can go down to Hyde Park and debate and share the gospel. Here, it's about eldership, i.e. men, but it can be applied to women as well in terms of those who are going down to debate and witness. If you're going to do a work for the Lord, it says there that a bishop must be blameless, a steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry. So you need to be, if you're going to go down to Hyde Park, especially on a regular basis, you need to be much in prayer, and you need to be walking right. So any things in your life that are not right, you need to ask the Lord to help you to deal with it, because you're not going to be effective at Hyde Park if you're debating every week and your life's not right. You've got to get your life right. You've got to get your life right and make sure that your life's right, and be a person of prayer. Be much in prayer. Okay? But then it says, verse 9, "Holding fast the faithful word as I've been taught, that you may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince." So you need to be a person who's studying the word of God. You need to be really, really studying the Word and studying the truths of God. Okay? So, your life, your conduct, your spiritual life, and being in the Word. Because I see people going down to Hyde Park, and you can tell the way they're conducting themselves, they're not walking right. You can see it clearly. Some people are going down there to debate, and they're just not clued up. They've not studied the Word of God. So these are some areas that you need to work on, some of you. You need to be praying, you need to be walking right, and you need to be in the Word of God, yeah? That's the first point. I'm saying these things to help you, to encourage you, yeah? I think if you go to Romans 16, it says, I command you unto Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church, which is at Caesarea. And then it says, verse 3, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus. And you could read that whole chapter, and it's not Paul on his own, but there's all sorts of people working at Rome for the gospel. And I would encourage you to really, really get a group of you working together. Meet up, pray together, study the Word together, go over issues together, and really build teams that are going down together at Hyde Park. Because what I've noticed is very often people at Hyde Park who are debating Christians, often they're isolated, they're on their own, and the Muslim groups gang around them, and you're on your own, and you get picked off because you've not got any backup, you've not got any support. Excuse me. So, you need to try and build a team working with you. You know, ask other people, are you interested in doing this ministry with me and working together? Someone on the camera, somebody who's gifted at the debating, someone who's gifted at the preaching, and someone who's gifted at knowing about atheism or Islam, and bringing it together. You know, ideally, it should be in a local church. Should be working with a local church. That is the biblical model. But if you are in a church, maybe there aren't any Christians there that want to come out, but maybe there are other Christians around that want to. So, but try and get a group of you together. Try and get a team. It's really important that you do try and build a team, because that will strengthen you and strengthen the work that you do in Hyde Park. Yeah. The next thing, if you turn to Acts chapter 7, so this is just preliminary thinking. Acts chapter 7 is Stephen sharing the gospel, and he goes through the Old Testament, and then it's a long, long sermon, and then he comes to the end, and he goes, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you do always resist the Holy Ghost, which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted. They have slain them who have received the law by the disposition of angels. When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart. If you go to Acts chapter 2, Paul's addressing the church at Antioch, and then he goes, therefore let all the house, verse 36, of Israel know surely that God hath made that same Jesus whom you have crucified both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? If you do a study of the sermons of the book of Acts, do a study when you get a chance. And do a study of the sermons in the book of Acts. I think I might have... I'll just see if I've got the notes here. got it here. So let's see if I've not got it. Sorry about that, I've not got it there in my notes. But if you go to the Book of Acts and just look up the sermons and study, the point that I want to make is stick to the gospel as much as you can. You're out there not to win debates ultimately. I'm not saying it's wrong to debate. You need to debate, you need to argue and whatever. But you need to focus on proclaiming the gospel more, proclaiming Jesus more. You're out there to save people. You're out there to save people, not to win debates, all right? So you need to be praying that God would help you to proclaim the gospel. Try and keep on the gospel as much as you can. I'm not saying don't debate, but always remember that a lot of these debates are rabbit trails designed to get you away from preaching the gospel. So as much as you can, preach the gospel, yeah? Okay, so that's just a few preliminary things. So, I'm going to just give you some pointers, some resources and pointers in debate and discussion with people. In terms of theology and knowing your stuff, I think if you go to if you go to Third Millennium Ministries is an online theological seminary, and there they have various courses that you can do for free. Also, Reformed Theological Seminary and Covenant Theological Seminary on iTunes have a lot of courses that you can do on the New Testament and Master's Seminary. And you can do courses on apologetics, you can do courses on philosophy, you can do courses on the Bible, and they really, really will help you and equip you in knowing your faith. So that's Reformed Theological Seminary iTunes, Covenant Theological Seminary iTunes, Legionnaire Ministries, Sermon Audio. If you go on Sermon Audio, there's loads of resources on there where you can find loads of courses on apologetics, courses on the Bible, etc. and other places that I've mentioned. So if you want to know about Christianity and be equipped in apologetics and things like that, that's helpful. Another apologist that will really, really help you is a guy called Greg Benson. He didn't debate Muslims, but he's given a lecture on Islam, and he's given some really helpful debates with atheists. And you can take his methodology and you can adapt it, and it really, really will give you some real ammo in being an apologist in debates and discussions with people. The other resource, again, is Answering Islam. It's very, very helpful in learning about Muslims and Islamic apologetics and how to answer Muslims. Okay, so those are resources. Reformed Theological Seminary, Covenant Theological Seminary, Sermon Audio, Legionnaire Ministries, and the C.S. Lewis Institute is very, very good in apologetics. And Labrie. If you go to their website, there's a lot of good apologetic material there about Christianity. So that's just some resources and things. So we're talking about, I just want to talk about Islam and give you some pointers about dealing with Muslims, yeah, in my own research and their apologetics. Try and do some research on the Quran in terms of the formation of the Quran. That is the one of their weakest points. They think it's their strong point, but it's their weakest point. Have a listen to a guy called Keith Small on the textual histories of the Quran and the New Testament. And he's found that there are variants within the ancient texts of the Quran, and he's done a lot of research on it. And try and do your own research and find out, and you'll be shocked to find that the evidence that the Muslim claims that the Quran has not changed it just doesn't stack up to inquiry. So do some research on that. That is one of their big weaknesses. I'll just read from a Muslim scholar. Muhammad Mustafa Al-Azami says, "We must nevertheless take into consideration that there are over 250,000 manuscripts of the Quran scattered all over the globe. When compared them, it's always possible to find copious mistakes here and there. This is an example of human fallibility and is being recognized as such by authors who have written extensively on the subject of unintentional errors. Such occurrences cannot be used to prove any corruption within the Quran." Now, he says that, but that is undermining the traditional view of what Muslims are saying about the Quran. This is the history of the Quranic text from revelation to compilation, a comparative study with Old and New Testament, Leicester, UK Islamic Academy, 2003. So he's trying to preempt an issue here that's a really dangerous issue for Muslims, and they'll probably change their view in the next few years, but they're on record of saying the Quran has not changed, and yet this scholar's saying there are variants within the Quran. Do some research on that. You'll find that when you look into the history of it, when you look into Uthman, who burnt the Qurans and the rest of it, you look into it, the formation of the Quran, there's a lot of material there that you'll find that undermines the integrity of the text of the Quran. So I'd encourage you to do that research. If you go on to Answering Islam, you'll find some books there that you can download on textual criticism of the Quran, and they're very helpful. And bring it up to the Muslims when you're talking to them and expose them on that. That is one of their weak points. I don't think we've exploited it even, we haven't even begun to fully exploit this issue. So I would encourage you to do more research on it and bring it to bear in debates at Hyde Park. You need to put the Muslim apologist on the spot. One of the things I've noticed in these debates, there are different styles of apologetics. There is what is called presuppositional apologetics, and then there's evidential apologetics. Evidential apologetics presents the evidence. Presuppositional apologetics deals with your presuppositions, right? So let me give you an example. Here's a Quran. And here's a Bible, right? Now, I'm the Muslim, right? And I ask you, the Christian, what is Mark chapter 10 about? I don't think it proves the Word of God. Let's have a look at it. So the Muslim asks, yeah? Now, you go to your Bible and try to explain it, but all the time, they're asking as a Muslim. So you're trying to answer from the Bible, but they are twisting it because they believe the Quran. And so they'll say, no, I don't agree with this, I don't agree with that. The foundation is the Quran. All right, another example. Muslim says Jesus didn't die on a cross. You say he died on a cross, right? So the Muslim says, show me the evidence that Jesus died on a cross. So there, you got your Bible, you give them the evidence, whatever, historical evidence from the Bible, other historical evidence, etc. But the Muslim is looking at it from the Quran's perspective, right? So it's like you've got your yellow glasses, they've got red glasses, and they're looking at the world from the red glasses, you're looking at the world from the yellow glasses, whatever. So what you need to do is, what I've found is the Muslims in Hyde Park, when I'm watching the videos, the Muslims are throwing questions at you about the Trinity and the Bible and this and that. And you're trying to answer, but they're coming all the time from the Quran's perspective. So what you need to do is you need to stop and say, wait a minute, you've asked your question, one question. Now let me ask you a question. And you need to start asking questions about the Quran. You need to ask them questions about the Quran. You need to study the Quran and ask them some penetrating, difficult questions, like, for example, when it talks about somebody dying on the cross, ask them, who died on the cross? If it wasn't Jesus, who? What's your evidence for the person dying in Jesus' place? And what I've noticed is whenever the Muslims are being asked questions, they find it very, very hard to answer. Very, very hard. Some of the best apologists in Hyde Park that I've seen, whenever they get questions thrown at them, they want to change the subject really quick and move on attacking the Bible. So you need to pin them down. You need to not let them pin you down on the Bible. Because they're looking at it from the Quran, so you're never going to be able to answer them until you destroy their confidence in this. Then they're going to be open to this. So you need to ask them questions about the Quran. And be critical, get them and put them on the spot. Ask them, where's the evidence for Muhammad being a prophet? Where's the evidence for Angel Gabriel seeing Muhammad seeing Angel Gabriel? Where's the evidence? And ask them the tough questions. Okay? So I'm just giving you some pointers. You need to, before you get to the evidence, you need to take down their presupposition. Their presupposition, their worldview, is they're looking at it through these glasses. And you need to smash these glasses so that they can be free to look at things in a more objective way. So you need to ask them questions about their Quran. Because the Muslims are throwing questions upon questions attacking the Bible. And you've got to stand back and say, whoa, wait a minute. Let me ask you a question. And put them on the spot. And too often the Christians are being polite and allowing question after question, and then you get battered from left to right, rather than just say, wait a minute, no, you've asked your question, let me ask a question, and then put them on the spot. You've got to start to do it much more than you're doing. All right? The other thing as well is don't let them shotgun you. Very often they throw in loads of questions. No, just so you've asked your question, let me give you a question. And keep it like that and keep control of it, yeah? The other thing as well is you've got to ask yourself, what is fruitful? Talking to people who are open to the gospel or talking to people who are just trying to pull you down? Which is more fruitful? Let's just turn to 2 John. The letter of John. John 3, I think it is. No, John, letter 2, to letter of John 2. For many deceivers, verse 7, are entered into the world who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought, but that we receive a full reward. Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth to the in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. And it goes on. John's letters kind of talk about, you know, you mustn't receive someone who's falsely teaching stuff. And there comes a point when some of these Muslim apologists, if they don't want to know, why waste your time with them? They're just going to try and pull you down. They're going to try and pull your arguments down. So what's the point? And I think it's time to leave these apologists alone and talk to people who really are open, who really want to know, and debate them and discuss with them. Rather than these hard-nosed Muslim apologists who are just trying to batter you down and score points, rather than really want to know what the truth is. So pick people who really are open and willing to have a dialogue with you. I read a book, and I'd encourage you to read it. It's very insightful. It's called the Cambridge Companion to Islam. If you read that book, Muslims actually quote it in their debates. They kind of like one scholar in there, and they quote it quite often from that book. But I just think we need to realise that comparing scholarship on the Quran with the scholarship on the Bible, someone, I've been in academic circles and seen academic studies with the Bible for many, many years, so I can compare that with this Cambridge Companion, and I can honestly say that you've got to be very, very careful, because we're not given the true picture of scholarship on the Quran today. In the 19th century, there was colonialism, that is, like people like Britain and France and Germany going around taking over African countries. And in the 20th century, there was a reaction to this colonialism, and the Arabs and the Muslims reacted to it. They didn't like it. And they've always thought the West wants to just take down Islam because of this colonialism. So Western scholars are very conscious of this, and they're very ashamed of their colonial past. So they pussyfoot around, they don't want to upset Islam. So what you tend to find, and you find it in this book concerning Islamic scholarship, Cambridge Companion, that you find that the scholars generally don't want to upset Islam, and they're not willing really to just come out and say very clearly what needs to be said about the formation of the Quran. So you get contradictions, like one German scholar in the book will say, oh, the Quran's been preserved, and yet blatantly admit there's never been a Quran produced based on all textual criticism, which is an absurd thing to say that we know that we've got the Quran when we haven't even done a formation of the Quran through all the text that we have. It just boggles the mind, but it just shows you that there is a lack of, so for example, there are scholars like Patricia Cohn and others that have been very critical of the origins of the Quran and Islam, but they've been sidelined in the academic world. They've been said, oh, to be proved wrong and whatever. But the reality is that there is this political correctness within the academic world in Islamic studies, which I found as I read the Cambridge Companion. And what that means is that Muslims are able to cherry-pick these scholars, Western scholars, that agree with them. So you've got to be aware that, you've got to be aware of these scholars, you've got to be aware of their agendas, and you've got to be able to, when these Muslims quote these scholars, you've got to be able to say, well, I've read that, and that person's scholarship is not as good as you're making it out to be. So in other words, you're at a disadvantage in a culture, an academic culture, that is not as honest as it should be. And I'm talking about Western scholars on the Quran. They're not as honest as the, for example, the Birmingham manuscripts. The scholars there, the academic scholars there, are just pussyfooting around. They're not willing to say the truth about the true situation. So what that means is you've got to dig, you've got to work that extra harder to get at the truth. You've got to go and really read and research and do your research so that you can cut through all this political correct scholarship that's around and get to the nitty-gritty of what the actual case is. And the problem is that a lot of Western Christians are not aware of this, so they might read a scholar who has been sort of said or blacklisted by the academic world, saying, oh, that scholar is critical of Islam, well, they're not really that intellectually credible. But they're downing on that scholar, not based on evidence, but based on conjecture, because really they're politically correct and they don't want to upset the politically correct apple cart. So you've got to be able to dig and do your own research and get to the bottom of the truth. So when you're in debate, you really, really know what you're talking about. You say, well, I've read that scholar, and that scholar's a bit biased, actually. And that scholar actually contradicts himself. So you're quoting that scholar, I'm sorry. You know, you might think that German scholar, she's a great scholar and she agrees with you, but she's also contradicting herself here. So, you know, you really need to know your stuff. You really need to know there's a lot of bias going on in the academic world at the moment, based on my reading of Cambridge Companion to the Quran. The, you know, if you read the scholarship of academic scholars for the last 300 years, Bultmann, you could go right back to the Ramirez and Wauhausen, people like that. But academic scholars have no compunction whatsoever attacking the Bible, criticising the Bible, saying all manner of things about the Bible, really undermining the Bible. It's not the same in Western academia concerning the Quran. There is a politeness there, there is a desire not to upset Muslims, a desire not to undermine Islam, etc. going on amongst many, the vast majority of Western academics and Islam. It's kind of like there's an infiltration of the left within academia. So you've got, if you're going to go into debates in Hyde Park, you need to know this and you need to do research on these scholars and you need to find out about them. You need to be able to pull them apart. And you need to be able to say when a Muslim quotes them, this is the true situation. All right? These are Western scholars who are doing so-called objective scholarship on the Quran. They're contradicting themselves, they're pussyfooting around, and you've got to be able to articulately deconstruct these scholars and then say, you know, be able, in debate, be able to be aware of that. Let alone know the scholarship of the actual orthodox kind of Islamic scholars. That's another task in itself. I'm just talking about the Western scholars, but even scholarship from the Muslim perspective, you need to be studying that, you need to be looking at what Muslim scholars are saying and thinking as well. Looking at how they approach topics and thinking. You need to be doing some spade work on studying the Quran, the Hadiths, the commentaries, and you need to be studying the Western scholars. You need to be informing yourself about Islam. And when you're doing it, it's not about debating or winning debates. It's about saving souls. If you turn to Galatians chapter 1, Galatians chapter 1 verse 4, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God and our Father. It's about saving souls. We owe it to ourselves to do the best job we can. If you're going to debate Muslims in Hyde Park, you need to do your research. And so it's about saving souls. It's about saving people's lives. People are going to go to hell. So you really, really need to do your homework. Look up the, if you're going to quote the Quran, make sure you've looked at the context. Make sure you've got the Arabic dictionary written down of the definition of whatever you're doing. Make sure you check your sources, etc. before you start quoting stuff or start saying anything about Islam. You need to go and check your sources, yeah? Okay. Yeah, I want to talk about scholarship and the Bible. You'll get some Muslim apologists in Hyde Park using Western scholars that attack the Bible. And so, for example, Paul Williams is a Muslim apologist. He'll say, well, the words in Acts are not that he'll say, well, the words in the book of Acts, they're not actually by Paul, they were just put in by Luke. Or the words in John, they're not actually the words of John, they were of Jesus, they were put in by John. So, a kind of working knowledge of the history of Western New Testament scholarship is really helpful. If you Google my lecture on Rudolf Bultmann, I gave a lecture, a New Year's lecture on Rudolf Bultmann. If you go and listen to that, that will help you. And I've done a couple of lectures on Rudolf, other lectures on Rudolf Bultmann, talks on Rudolf Bultmann. But if you know a little bit of the history of New Testament scholarship, it will help you to be able to take on these things. So what happens is that these Muslim apologists, sometimes they'll attack the Bible and say, well, you're quoting John, but you know, Jesus didn't even say that. John's just put it in. Or, you know, this book of Acts, it's not even the words of the apostles. It was just put in by Luke. You know, if you look at the history of scholarship, for example, on the Gospels and the historical Jesus studies, there was deists and pantheists who were against the Christian faith and wanted to undermine the Gospel. So they came up with theories of community, saying that these Gospels were late writings and that communities just invented them. And so they came up with these ideas of community. And so when you say the Bible says this, oh no, it was a community that invented that and stuck it in, it wasn't what Jesus spoke. So you need to understand that these are theories about community, theories about how community and oral tradition developed. They're theories not based on any evidence, but just conjecture. So when people say, oh, John didn't say this, Jesus didn't say this, or Luke didn't say, Paul didn't say that, or whatever, it's not based on any solid evidence. It's just conjecture, theories of community. Yeah? So, I'll give you an example. There's a guy called Dr. Bauer. He wrote a seminal work in the 1930s or... But he certainly came into... It was like a massive, massive bombshell in academia. And basically his idea was that only the winners, when we look at the New Testament, there were different ideas of what the truth was, and it was the winners that won out. This theory was massive at the turn of the First World War. And then, because he was German, he kind of was forgotten for a while, and then in the 1970s his book was published and it's had a massive effect on biblical scholarship. So what that means is, right off the bat, scholars just don't even begin to think that the Gospels have anything really to say. They don't even think there's any real historical stuff there because of Bauer's ideas. So, but these ideas are contradicted when you look at the historical information, that there was a clear proclamation of the death and resurrection of Christ. And so these theories about, there was many, many ideas about what the truth was, is just not correct. So, if you just have a little bit of history of New Testament, the history of New Testament scholarship, it gives you a little bit of resource in being able to deconstruct these Muslim apologists who kind of attack the Bible. So if let's say Paul Williams says to me, oh well, Luke doesn't say what it said. Paul in Acts, it's not really Paul's words. I'll just say to them, well, give me some evidence. What's your evidence? What scholars are you quoting? He might even quote evangelical scholars. Possibly he might even do that. We need to turn around to him and say, yeah, well, do you realise these ideas are based on certain ideas of community that are conjectural and not actually based on any evidence? So let's get back to the real evidence. The real evidence is, he might say, well, there was a Greek historian, Thucydides. He compressed people's talks and added information in, so that's how they did it. Well, what about Suetonius? You read Suetonius and you read his historical method and what he said about history, how we should write history. He was saying that we should get at the truth. So if you look at some ancient Greek historians, don't actually back up this theory that historians just put in what they wanted to put in. See, having a bit of information like that can help you to stop those kind of arguments. Oops. Same with the Gospel of John. Community theories, which are in what is called formed criticism, are behind a lot of this attack. And you can also give information. By Colin Hermer, gives 80 confirmed facts of the Gospel of Acts. He's a secular historian and he studied the book of Acts and he found that the Gospel of Acts are accurate. The Gospel of Acts is accurate, etc. So, sorry about this. Another argument that Muslims make is, so much to go on there, that, you know, all the Gospels were copied by Mark. All the Gospels, three other Gospels were copied from Mark, and it's like 90% in Mark, 90% of the Gospel in Luke is from Mark and Matthew, etc. And what that kind of idea is, it's trying to undermine the authority of four Gospels. Trying to get you to think that only one Gospel, it's trying to brainwash you to think there's not much evidence here, it's just one person's view, and then the other three have copied. But that's not the case. If you actually study the Gospels, there's tons of material that are not in each of the Gospels, that each Gospel has unique material in, and shows you that they are independent eyewitnesses. And the enemy tries to get at this, the four Gospels. And so I would encourage you to study the material that is different within the Gospels and show that these are independent witnesses. Because Hamza often brings that argument up. The other one is to know a little bit about textual criticism. That's you can download that. It's called The Providential Preservation of the Text of the New Testament. You can download that and that gives you a little bit of information on textual criticism. I've done a bit of research. We could go into lots more. I've done quite a bit of research on textual criticism. And the Muslims say, well, the last ending of Mark's not in the Bible. I've done loads of research on it. And there's loads and loads of information there that you can actually, you know, I'll give you a book to read. Is it in here? It's not in here, sorry. But I did some research on the last ending of Mark and I found many, many manuscripts and much information to show you that we have over 1,000 manuscripts of the Gospel of Mark with the last ending in. And the argument is, well, the oldest manuscripts that we have, the Sinaiticus of Vaticanus, it's not in there, so therefore it's not in the Bible. But Irenaeus quotes it. And there's other quotations before Sinaiticus and Vaticanus. The Gnostics are quoting it. There are only a few years after the Sinaiticus manuscripts that we have with it in. And manuscripts are put into families. You have one family, four families mainly, like the Alexandrian family and etc. The Byzantine family, etc. And your manuscript, if it's a good manuscript, it should be attested in four families, the four families. The modern argument that it's not in is only attested by the Egyptian family. The argument that it's in the text, the last ending, is attested, the manuscript in four families, the last ending marks in. That's pretty solid evidence that the last ending of Mark should be in there, all right? A lot of these scholars are just taking it on board because other scholars have said, but when you go into the actual detail and study it in depth, you find that there's no evidence there. So you need to do research and not just accept what scholars are saying on these things and not give grant to the Muslim, because you say in a debate, oh yeah, that shouldn't be in there. You've lost the debate if you say that. You need to say, no, I can give you evidence that the last ending Mark is in there. Same for the John 8, same for evidence for the passage in where it says there are three that bear witness in 1 John. There's lots of evidence to show that that should be in the text. So I wanted to cover a lot more ground. I'm a bit tired. But if I've just helped you to realise that you really, really need to prepare yourself, your heart, mind, your soul, your will. You're not out there to debate, you're out there to save souls. And that's the main thing. But if you go out there, you need to be equipped. And you need to know your stuff, you need to do your research, you need to prepare yourself. And I'm just giving you, talking about the Cambridge Companion to the Quran is just to show you that if you haven't done the study in that just one area, you're at a disadvantage. And talking about the history of New Testament scholarship, if you haven't done any study there, you're at a disadvantage, you see. So that's all I'm saying is just, you know, be prepared. Prepare yourself before you go down. You know, if you're going to go down there, have some notes on a particular topic that you're going to talk about and have your pointers and be prepared that way, and that will help you to know what to say. Sorry for going on. I hope that's a help. I've got loads of things that I wanted to say and things, but just go down there and make sure that you're prepared, yeah? Philippians chapter 1. It says, Paul and Timothy, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus which are at Philippi, with the bishops and deacons, grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which have begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Christ. Even as it is meet for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bond and in the defence and confirmation of the gospel, you are partakers of my grace. I think a good video to watch is Greg Banson, and he gives you information about how to debate people. And it's really, really good video, a couple of good videos. Just type in, you can look at them on YouTube. They're really, really helpful videos about how to debate and stuff like that. So I'm sorry if I've waffled on, but I'm just trying to help you a little bit. If this video just makes you think, you know what, I need to be a bit more prepared than I am. I could have given you arguments against the Quran, arguments to defend the faith, but I wanted just to talk about scholarship to open your eyes to see that studying widely and preparing yourself will help you to take these questions. You know, for example, like one of the Muslim apologists, Paul Williams, will ask you about a passage in Mark, and he'll ask you a question. Well, Jesus says there's none but God who was good, and he'll ask you these questions. But if you've done your preparation, you've done your studying, and you've studied the book of Mark, then you're able to answer questions. You're able to be able to answer them. And that's what I'm trying to get you to do, to be more prepared in your preparation before you go down there. That's all I'm saying. Sorry for waffling on, but I hope that helps you. If you want to keep in contact with me, go to jasonburnspreacher.com. jasonburnspreacher.com. If you want to join our team when we go down to Hyde Park, please let me know. If you want to help us and support us when we go down to Hyde Park, we've got a trip to Hyde Park coming soon, and so if you want to help us, be with us, join us, or come and study with us up in Manchester, spend some time with us up in Manchester and get to know us and build a team with us so that we can work together down in London together, let me know. If you want to work together as a church in London and you want to help us reach out in London, let us know. If you want to team up in London with us, we could go down there, study with you. You come up here, study with us. We have a passion to reach people. And if you want to study partners where we can study together, study Islam, study apologetics, study theology, we can come down to you. You can come up to us, or we could study by Skype or by some other means or whatever. So my website's jasonburnspreacher.com, and you can get my phone number there and get in contact with me. If there are Muslims out there that want academic debate, or atheists, let me know. I'm happy to debate you in a professional academic capacity. But this video is principally for Christians who just go down Hyde Park and think they can just debate people without any preparation. I think you need to think again and prepare yourself. And all right, thank you for listening, and God bless you. I'm just going to pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. And Father, we thank you for your blessings. And Father, I just pray that this video, a lot of rambling, Lord, and not much information really, but just sharing my concern, the need to be prepared. And I pray that, Father, your people would go down to Hyde Park prepared. And that, Father, you would bless them. And you would help them. And you would strengthen them. And that, Father, they would just go from strength to strength. And that you bless their ministries and unite the Christians. Help them to proclaim your gospel. Help them to preach your word. And Father, just bless them in all that they do for you. And just enrich their ministry. And bless them. And may many, many souls come to know you at Hyde Park. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, Jason Burns gets beaten by Muslim apologists. Will it ever happen? Well, they might think so, but I'm always going to be prepared. I'm always going to be preparing myself, always studying the Word, reading, praying, and lifting up the Lord, you know. And if we do that, then the Lord will protect us, the Lord will help us. And if we go prepared, we prepare ourselves, then, you know, we're less likely to get destroyed in debate, or less likely to get taken down by these kind of Muslim apologists. You know, we've got to be in the Word and preparing ourselves. All right, and I hope that this has encouraged you to prepare yourself. God bless you and take care. And may it never be said of you, may they never make a video of you, yet another Christian has been beaten in debate or destroyed in debate by Muslim apologists. May it never be said of you, because you've taken notice of this video and you say, you know what, this is serious business. We're not out here to debate. We're not out here to entertain. We're out here to save souls. And I need to be the best servant possible. I need to prepare my heart. I need to prepare myself in prayer. I need to magnify the Lord and preach the gospel. And I need to know what the Muslims think. I need to be able to answer the questions. But I'm going to go out there and prepare myself as best I can and be the best ambassador that God has called me to be. And if you do that, it will not be Muslim, Christian is destroyed yet again by a Muslim apologist. It will be Muslim saved at Hyde Park. What's going on? Revival is at work. Yeah? God bless you and take care. May God be with you. And I hope that this has been a blessing to you or a help. All right? God bless you and take care.